Hello and welcome to this video on assignments, contacts, typing judgments, and rules in the Hindley-Milner type system. It's a lot to get through, there's going to be a lot of syntax, so take it slowly, rewatch the video, pause if you have to at points, have a think, maybe do some of your own examples, but hopefully all of this will make sense and it will get you a long way to understanding all that syntax for Hindley-Milner. In previous videos, we've looked at the lambda calculus, we've looked at what makes an expression and how we can represent that as a grammar. So here we have an expression E with variables, application, abstraction, and let bindings. We also looked at types in Hindley-Milner. So we've got monotypes represented by that tau and polytypes represented by that sigma. But up to this point, we haven't actually been able to glue the two together. So we haven't been able to glue lambda expressions to Hindley-Milner types. So that's what we're going to do now. We're going to use these things called assignments. So an assignment is one of these, where we have an expression on the left, a colon, and then a type on the right represented by that sigma. So expression, type there. And we'd read this saying, the expression E has type sigma. So for a practical example, you might say there's a variable called age. We're gonna say that's a variable expression and it has type int or integer. And if you used other programming languages, you might be familiar or at least somewhat familiar with the syntax. Often they use colons. You can often see it in method or function signatures, etc. So we've got these assignments now, but we need to store them somewhere. We need some kind of representation so we can reason and logic about them. And also, you know, if you're writing a compiler or type checker, part of a compiler, you need to actually store them. And where you'd store them is a context, which is effectively just a list of assignments. You'll see it's particularly similar to a linked list in the way we kind of define it in a grammar, but it could be represented really in many ways. We often use the symbol capital gamma. It looks kind of like a reflected capital L symbol. So that's capital gamma is our context, and it's going to be a list of these assignments. So here this is saying our context capital gamma has an assignment age is an integer, and another assignment odd is a function which takes an integer and returns a boolean. Another piece of notation we're going to use for context is similar to set notation. We can say a certain assignment is in a context. As it's just a list of these assignments, this is basically saying age is integer is contained within the context capital gamma. So how do we represent this as a formal grammar? Well, there's lots of different ways. This is one way where we can say we either start with an empty list or we can say it's a context with more assignments. So effectively building up from that empty list and adding more assignments. But if you're not a fan of formal grammars, all you have to remember is a context is a list of assignments. So we've got assignments now, which tell us what expressions have what types. They relate those two together. We've got contexts, which are lists of assignments. But what can we do with them? Well, we can make typing judgments, which is when an assignment follows, given the context, we can make a typing judgment. They look something like this. So this is saying, our context capital gamma, from that it follows that expression E has type sigma. So that little kind of rotated leftwards capital T means it follows that. For a practical example, let's take our context from a couple slides ago. We can say from this context, it follows that age has type int. Because age has type int is directly in the context, well, it's got to follow. It's kind of obvious that yes, if this context was the case, well, age definitely does have type int. You can do more exciting things than just kind of restating statements in the context though. For example, you might say, well, odd age has type bool. How do we work that out? Well, we can say age is of type integer, odd is of type integer to bool. So when we pass the argument age into odd, we're passing an integer into a function which takes an integer and returns a bool, so we get a bool back. So you might think, well, that makes sense in my head, but how do we actually represent this in a compiler or in a formal system? We do that through typing rules. To keep things simple, we'll go back to our easy example where we're just pulling something out of the context. Here we can see, well, the context has age has type int in it, so we can just pull that out. Really what this is saying is that the context almost implies that it follows that age has type int from the context. And really if we want to boil this down to its essence, well, the actual odd statement in there doesn't really matter. It's really all about the age has type int statement that we're actually pulling out of there. And remember, we can write this a slightly different way. We can say, well, age is type int is in the context using that kind of set in notation. And that's the real rule at the core of this, right? Because any context, no matter all the other statements or all the other stuff around it, as long as it has that assignment in it, well then it follows that H is type int given that context. We can make this more generic actually, so we can say if any variable has a certain type in the context, well then it follows that that variable must have that type. It's actually quite a simple rule when you think about it. It's basically saying, well, you can just take things out of the context and it has to follow that if the context is telling the truth, well, then, you know, that's got to be the type of X. Often you'll see this written in a particular way. It's usually with a line in between. So you have some kind of thing at the top, some kind of thing at the bottom. We call this the premise and the conclusion. The conclusion is always a typing judgment. The premise may be other things. We're not going to formally define them, but they can be formally defined. If we wanted to read this typing rule, we might say X having type sigma being in the context means that or implies that X has type sigma follows from the context. Again, this is a very kind of simple or obvious rule when you think about it, but you can think you can use this formal system to define more exciting rules that maybe do the things that we saw with the odd age example where we have function application. We've also got potentially rules for function abstraction and let. And that's really the core essence of the Hindley-Milner type system. If you understand that we can use these typing rules to think about how we can figure out types, how we can build up types, then you're a long way along the way to understanding Hindley-Milner. There's also other things about what rules to apply when, how to choose different rules, generalization, polytypes, but we'll get to those in good time. That's been a lot of syntax for one video, a lot of new stuff, a lot of new definitions. Let's go and recap that. So what should we have? We had assignments where we say an expression has some type sigma. We have contexts, which can either be, you know, empty, so when we're starting, or we can add assignments to them. And remember, contexts are basically just lists of assignments. We've got judgments, which is when an assignment follows from a context. And we've got conclusions, which are always just judgments. And then we've got rules, where we've got some premise, which is saying, you know, given that some premise, the conclusion must be true. The conclusion is a judgment, so really we're saying that some assignment must follow from the context. Thanks for watching. I know we've covered a lot in a short time. Maybe it'll be worth pausing the video, going back, thinking about some examples. We'll also start to use these concepts in future videos as we look at how do we use our previous learnings about free variables, Hindley-Milner types, and all these Hindley-Milner contexts and other definitions to determine what are free variables in contexts, what are free variables in types, and why does it matter.